Okay, I think we're going to get started. Really great to see so many people here, especially some of the younger alums. My name is SoA Wang. I'm class of 1996, and on behalf of the Williams Asian and Asian American Alumni Network, it's my pleasure to welcome everyone to today's event with Harry Yoon, class of 1993. This is actually our second Zoom with Harry this year, which just goes to show it's been quite a whirlwind year for him, and we're excited to hear all about it. Back in April, we talked to Harry about his work on Minari, an introspective immigrant story that earned six Oscar nominations, among many other accolades. Today, we're going to hear from Harry about his editing on a completely different type of film, Marvel's first superhero movie with an Asian lead, Shang-Chi and the Legend of the Ten Rings, which I hope you've all watched. This movie's got everything. It features both big name stars and promising newcomers, mixture of East and West, past and present, action, and more action. So even though it's only been 6 months since we last spoke, the world has sort of opened up since then. So it'll also be interesting to hear how the movie industry is navigating our not yet post-COVID world. So without further ado, let me turn things over to Harry and our moderators for today, who are Angela Yu, class of 2020, and Lindsay Wang, a current sophomore at Williams and a features editor at the Williams Record. Turning it over.
Hi, everybody. Thanks so much for coming. It's so good to see so many familiar names and faces. My old sweet mate from Sage E is here, Daniel Silva. So it's great to see you, Daniel, as well as people I used to sing a cappella with, not in the same group, but definitely like sort of in the a cappella world. So great to see all these familiar faces. I'm excited to talk to you guys.
Yeah, so thank you all for coming, and thank you to Harry for being here with us tonight, or virtually. Just to kind of start off the conversation and to situate ourselves, could you kind of explain to us, you know, what your main focus and responsibilities were as an editor for Shang-Chi?
Sure. I came on sort of a little bit later in the process than I traditionally come on for a feature film. In features, generally, the editor starts the first day of production, so when they start shooting. And that's so that as soon as they shoot the next day, we'll have the first day's what's called dailies or footage, and then we start cutting right away. The reason that that's advantageous for production is that as the director or the assistant directors or the producers have questions about how things are going or whether or not they can wrap out of a particular location, we can be responsive and let them know, yes, you have everything, or wait, it'd be great if we had one additional shot that would help smooth things out. So that's usually when an editor begins. I didn't start with the production. The first two editors were Nat Sanders, who is a longtime editor for the director, Destin Daniel Cretton, and Elizabeth Ronald's daughter, who's a legendary, badass, sort of Icelandic woman editor who cut things, movies like Deadpool and John Wick. And so the two of them started with Destin, I think December of 2019 in Australia. And a few months into shooting, the production got shut down because of COVID. And so they had a delay of several months when they weren't shooting. And so by the time they finished shooting and they had done an initial cut, Elizabeth unfortunately needed to move on to her next show. And so they needed another editor to take over for her. So I picked up where she left off once everybody moved from Australia to the US, and we began probably the most intense phase of Marvel, of editing on a Marvel film, which is the producer's cut, where the director, the editors start working with the Marvel Brain Trust, including Kevin Feige, Louis Desposito, and Victoria Alonso, who've been involved with Marvel films ever since Iron Man. And it's a process of watching the cut, brainstorming ideas on how to improve it, testing those ideas with an actual audience, and in this case, there were virtual screenings without audience, and you know, cycle and repeat basically for several months while we refine the story, the characters, the performances, et cetera, and all the way to the bitter end until they finally sort of like take the film out of our hands and we have to release it. So I was involved during that producer's cut process here in Los Angeles.
Wow, so a long journey. I mean, how did it kind of feel knowing that you were coming into this production team a bit later? Like, how did you feel like finding out that you had gotten this role?
Well, I mean, after Minari finished, basically, and, you know, premiered at Sundance, soon after that, I was supposed to work on a boxing film in March. We started shooting, and literally 2 days into production, we got shut down due to COVID. And so for the next 9 months, I didn't work. I worked on other projects, but no real cutting of features or television. And so I was really sort of dying a little bit inside, really wanting to sort of like, it was wonderful because that was during the time of Minari's release and awards run and everything. But at the same time, I was really ready to get back into the saddle. And to have, and to get a call saying like, you know, Marvel might be looking for another editor for Shang-Chi was like a dream come true. I remember the year before just seeing the announcement that Destin Cretton, who's one of my favorite directors, he directed movies like Short Term 12 and Just Mercy and really beautiful films that focus on, you know, stories of marginalized characters and really sort of, you know, calling in. I think you see in his films this incredible appreciation for, I don't know, just the human story and privileging of people who normally don't get in the spotlight. And so I just really love his work. And hearing that he was directing the first Asian American Marvel film, I was like, someday in my life, I'll get a chance to work on a show like that. Because I mean, the scale of it was so huge. And, you know, I mean, I wasn't necessarily sort of obviously on that list because I'd worked on a lot of smaller films as an editor. But getting that call, especially the notice that Minari got, was like a dream come true. And so I came into it and was really lucky to be able to interview and then ultimately get the job. And I was so scared initially because, you know, I mean, Nat Sanders is an Oscar nominated editor for Moonlight and, you know, a lot of Destin's other films. Elizabeth Ronald's daughter is a legend in her own right. And just trying to fill those shoes was a little nerve-wracking. In fact, my first day on the job, you know, after I closed the door to my office and started looking at footage, I just felt this like tremendous sense of like imposter syndrome. I was like, when are they going to find out they made this terrible mistake in hiring me? But literally sort of scene by scene, day by day, cut for cut, and, you know, conversation, brainstorming session by brainstorming session, I felt a little bit more at home and part of the family. And, you know, one of the wonderful aspects of that is that Destin, he's from Hawaii. So he has this incredible kind of aloha spirit in his bones. He makes you feel a part of the family. He really sort of, you know, treats everybody with like dignity and civility, like every crew member, not just, you know, his department heads, like his editors, but the PAs and interns and, you know, the VFX coordinators, everybody. And so, when you walk into a cutting room like that, working where a culture that's so welcoming from the top down, it really puts your mind at ease and you can do your best work. And so after a little while, I felt very much at home and very, very excited to be a part of the process.
It's amazing to hear like how much of a sense of community you guys were still able to create even, you know, while you were producing during COVID. And I was kind of wondering, like, how much the editing process was, you know, changed by the simple fact that, you know, I assume you guys weren't really on set all the time, or?
Yeah, I mean, there were some really stringent COVID protocols, testing protocols, masking protocols, all the way through production. And I think it took Hollywood, you know, several months to kind of figure out where that tolerance lay between, you know, being cautious, but, you know, wanting to move forward and to restart production. You know, one of the short-term jobs I did was, you know, I did a week of on-set editing for a new movie that's coming out called King Richard, starring Will Smith. And I remember like the kind of masks and face shields and testing that we had to do, being tested 3 to 4 times a week. It just felt like, you know, this relentless, you know, knowledge that COVID was just sort of like surrounding all of us. And so it was a very scary time. Towards the end of that process, especially as we started going into editorial, thankfully, you know, the vaccines were available, you know, became available. We became more comfortable sort of being in the same building with each other, but we still had all these different protocols to make sure that we were as safe as possible throughout, including masking and things like that whenever we were in a room together for a long time. And it also led to some really interesting, during the post-production process, it also led to some really interesting situations. So for example, normally we go through a process called the sound mix, where we're usually with mixers watching a movie theater size screen, listening to the sound and doing tweaks, like changing the volume of like music or effects, or, you know, changing the quality of the mix, how it surrounds you. And usually that's all done in one room, but because of limitations on how many people could be in a room for a certain period of time, we actually had to have our mixers up in Marin at the Skywalker sound stages while we were all down in Los Angeles. And so we were literally sharing a fiber pipe that connected us, but it was so surreal to have to mix virtually in a process that's usually so spontaneous and so, you know, full of these little exchanges and ideas that you normally have with the key people that you collaborate with. And we did a lot of like remote shoots with actors that happened to be in other places because they couldn't fly in due to COVID restrictions. And so, you know, one of the things that Marvel does on a regular basis, and this is really smart about their process, is that they plan to do 2 to 3 weeks of reshoots on every movie. And so they put that into the schedule. And so we actually did our reshoots in spring of this year. And so many of our actors had already moved on to other projects. They couldn't fly in because they would have had to quarantine. And so we had to do all these sort of remote shoots where Michelle Yeoh was in London, for example. We were talking to her through Zoom, you know, while she was delivering these brand new lines, you know, that we had written to sort of like clarify a point of character. And we had to sort of like, and Destin had to direct her remotely. And so there were these strange situations like that were a byproduct of COVID that were a little bit stumbling blocks, but, you know, I think we got them through okay. And the final product is hopefully something that everybody's enjoying.
Yeah, definitely. it really sounds like, to a certain extent, COVID kind of, I wouldn't want to say forced, but kind of fostered like innovation in terms of like creating movies. Like, do you think that there were positive aspects also to having to kind of change the editing process because of COVID?
I think maybe not so much. Well, I can think of one specific instance on this film that isn't so much about protocol, that is about an idea that I think Destin and the other two editors had while they were in Australia and they were shut down for a while. Is I think what happened was that they weren't 100% sure about what was going to happen in the third act, meaning sort of the back half of the film. And being shut down for a while allowed them to see the footage that they had shot up to that point. And that started to inform some brainstorming about what could happen. And during that time in which they were shut down, they were also able to kind of brainstorm about different structures that the story could be told in. So one thing that your audience might not know if they've watched the film is there's a lot of use of flashbacks, for example, in the film. And that's one of the narrative conceits of the film, is that little by little through these flashbacks, you get a sense of Shang-Chi's backstory. But originally, all of those past scenes were in a 20-minute long prologue where you saw the entire history of Wenwu and the rings leading all the way up to, you know, him meeting his wife who became Shang-Chi's mother, all the way, et cetera, to finally we get to present day. And they knew even up front that probably wasn't going to work because you can't spend 20 minutes before you see your title character on screen. And so this helped them start that brainstorming process of saying, okay, can we restructure the film in that way? And pretty quickly, as soon as Destin finished shooting, he worked with the other two editors to come up with that flashback structure. And one of the nice things about my coming on as an editor later on is because I wasn't privy to all of that thinking and all of that planning, I could come in with fresh eyes to let them know, okay, it's mostly working, it's beautiful, here's what I don't understand. And here's what I think could be clearer. And start to brainstorm ideas with them of either moving flashbacks, shortening them, expanding them, or adding other scenes to clarify some of the exposition so it felt organic and natural to the story as it was told.
Oh, that's so cool to hear. That seems like such a different, like that would have been such a different movie if that had happened.
Yeah.
coming into the movie as, you know, like, you know, late and as an editor, like were there ways that you prepared for the role, or were you just kind of, I'm here, now I'm gonna edit?
Well, I think the past 20 years of working as an assistant editor and editor is what kind of prepared me to take the reins. You know, one of the things that I did while between assistant editing and editing was I was the visual effects editor on a number of large movies, like Catherine Bigelow's Zero Dark Thirty and Inarritu's The Revenant. And that gave me a sense of the pipeline and the process for visual effects, how to sort of like anticipate in editorial what things should look like to get them to a place where you can turn them over to a visual effects house, how to sort of dialogue with visual effects artists and supervisors to have a sense of like what's possible, when you're going to see something that's ultimately going to impact the cut. So being very comfortable in those waters as a visual effects editor, I think really helped prepare me for how Marvel shows, which are incredibly visual effects heavy. But also like having worked in the studio system as an assistant editor also helped me to understand sort of the rhythms of, you know, all the things that have to happen in post-production, the music composition that needs to happen, the sound design that needs to happen, the color, the visual effects. And often because time is of the essence on a Marvel film, a lot of those processes have to happen in parallel. And so to not freak out that like you've got like four or five burners going in your kitchen, right? To understand sort of when this egg's gonna be ready or that, because I've gone through that process a number of times through, you know, coming up in the system, I think that really helped me to be a responsive person that kind of interacts and leads some of that process. So that really, really helped.
Yeah, that's really great to hear how much like your prior experience informed your experience of editing Shang-Chi. And I was particularly interested, I mean, you have such a wealth of experience, like you've edited for Minari and Euphoria and Last Black Man, like so many different types of, you know, films and media. And Shang-Chi, of course, is also another type. It's particularly a Marvel action film. So in what ways was editing for Shang-Chi different or similar to your previous projects?
I think the way that it was similar was, you know, Destin told me afterwards, I asked him sort of, you know, we were talking about the process of, you know, him finding another editor. And I think one of the things he mentioned was that a lot of the directors and producers that he talked to before hiring me spoke to the kind of responsiveness that I have in delivering new ideas and being sort of fearless, but respectful during that process. I think editors have to be consultative by nature. And so that skill set of sort of, you know, being able to generate new ideas without being overbearing is a kind of art form that I think you have to develop over time. Like you want to nurture the original vision enough so that the people that you're working with feel comfortable because they're often so vulnerable with you. But you also want to be generative. You want to be somebody that helps them see things differently. And that's one of the things that I think having a vastly different types of projects that I've worked on have given me a facility with saying like, okay, just think a little bit out of left field, you know, to think of comic undertones in drama or vice versa, that type of thing, and to solve a number of different types of problems depending upon the genre. And so I think those things really inform my ability to be solutions oriented when we were confronted with a question like, okay, if we cut these 8 minutes out of the last act, how do we make this, you know, what's left feel emotionally satisfying, or what feels essential or doesn't feel essential in, you know, this middle section here, or, you know, how do we make this, you know, drive through the bamboo forest a little bit more engaging or a little bit more fun with the footage that we have. So all sorts of different problems. I think having a variety of experience gave me a bigger tool set or toolbox to address those things.
Yeah. And in terms of differences, it sounds like the Marvel production was, I mean, it's Marvel. It's just such a big production. Did it feel like different just from sort of the smaller, more independent projects that you worked on?
Oh, without question. Like here's a telling detail. The Marvel reshoots were a minimum of 15 days of production with a huge crew. Minari as an independent film was about 22 days of production for the entire feature. So, you know, almost 75% of the production schedule is what we devoted in Marvel from reshoots, which is insane. There were certain visual effects directions that we took with some of the CG characters, the cost of which was the entire budget of a film like Minari. And so, I mean, when I started to sort of understand those sort of like contrasting scales, it kind of blew me away. But, you know, I think what I really, the other thing that was really unusual and interesting about the Marvel process was how, because of the reshoots, because of the brainstorming process, for example, most major films do one or two audience feedback screenings in order to gauge what's working or not working in a film. Those screenings, because of the logistics involved, cost tens of thousands of dollars at a minimum. And I'm not even talking about like how to do it during COVID, but Marvel, I think, does a minimum of 5 audience feedback screenings, and they look through all of the cards. I mean, this is what's so mind-blowing, is that these executives that have been in charge from the beginning, they still worry over these like small details and things that are confusing, or things that, or a comment that says like, I don't know if I buy the relationship between Shang-Chi and Katie in this aspect. And then we'll brainstorm about, well, okay, well, how do we make this more believable? Is it a line here? Is it a look here? And those little building blocks are the things that go into the basket for reshoots. And so, like, for example, here's a small example. In the bus scene, for example, we might see a clip of the bus scene, for example. There, the kind of looks that are exchanged between Shang-Chi and Katie, like in certain beats of the fight, we reshot, because they were fine for the way they were, but we wanted to improve clarity of their relationship, you know, 5%. And so we'd reshoot those looks. Another thing that makes that possible in a Marvel film, which is fascinating, is that after the actors are done, everybody stops and they clear the set, and then they shoot all of the backgrounds with like 3D, what's called balls and charts and stuff like that, so that every angle that we've shot becomes a reusable angle. So we don't have to go back to that bus. We don't have to go back to that location. And so what Marvel is doing is every location that they've shot in becomes a digital backlot for potentially future scenes. Now, if you think about that within a film, that's super useful for reshoots and for changing dialogue and changing looks and things like that. But because there's so much crossover in the Marvel universe, that any location that's been used, you can reuse with other characters potentially for some of those crossover scenes that you've seen. And so if you start to think about like the possibilities of that, it's kind of mind-blowing. And this is something that they started very early on. And, you know, so for example, some of the backgrounds that you see in, you know, hopefully most people have seen the movie, in like some of the tag scenes in the world of Doctor Strange, for example, those were part of the digital backlot sets that they shot during Doctor Strange. And so that's what's so mind-blowing about the Marvel process.
Yeah, that is crazy to hear just how deep, I mean, just how connected also just the MCU is to each other. Yeah. It's great that you brought up the bus scene, because we actually do plan to show a clip of that. Passing awesome. It off to Angela.
Thanks, Lindsay.
Thanks, Lindsay, and thank you, Harry. So I was hoping to talk a little bit more in detail about the editing process for this film. And to start that conversation, we're going to start off with a clip, which is the bus scene, from the bus scene that everyone so loves.
Awesome.
You have the wrong guy. Does he look like he can fight? Come on, bro.
You okay?
What up, y'all? It's your boy Clev coming at you live on the bus. I actually did take a little bit of martial arts as a youth, so I'm gonna try and grade this fight as we're going.
So there's so much to talk about, even in just this tiny scene. So this is one of the first major action-driven scenes where Katie finds out that Shang-Chi is a fighter. So could you tell us more about what an editor looks out for in putting together a scene like this and what the most interesting and challenging aspects of it are? There must be like a lot of stunt choreography, like CGI and VFX involved.
Absolutely. So the one caveat is I didn't edit this scene because most of my work was in the back half of the film, but I really wanted to show this clip anyway because it's my favorite scene in the movie too. And I think it sort of gives us a chance to talk about what some of the specific kind of editing that it takes, especially on an action-driven film like this. Because this kind of a scene, if it's done well, and part of what makes it so exciting is that there's a dance between the camera and the action in a way where there's a seamless kind of revealing or pushing in or pulling out that happens in response to the moves, like that sort of like final split kick, for example, has a camera out that's timed perfectly to it. Because that kind of coordination has to be seamless, almost every major action scene is pre-done a number of different ways. The first way it's done is with the choreographers to talk about. Obviously, Destin is working with the incredible stunt choreographers that we have, many of whom actually worked with Jackie Chan. And so there's that sort of blend of humor and acrobatics and rhythm and, you know, close contact fighting and things like that that you see evident in a scene like this, that's, you know, emblematic of a lot of Jackie Chan films. They actually film shot for shot their proposal for what this stunt choreography should look like. And what they'll do is like, they'll put up like, you know, cardboard boxes to say, here's what the bus window is. And, you know, they'll have like folding chairs to say like, here's where the people are seated and things like that. And they'll move a camera around to say like, hey, this is what we think. This is the best angle to capture a kick, or this is the best angle to capture the receiving of the punch. So unlike dramatic scenes where you're shooting a lot of what's called coverage, where you shoot a wide shot, a two shot, and over, single, maybe a moving master, the shots for these stunt heavy scenes are planned out literally shot for shot. And if it can't happen through that sort of like, you know, home movie style stuff that I talked about, it will happen through what's called a process of pre-visualization, where we take 3D characters and have them do things like fly through space and, you know, smash into a building or something like that, all in this very sort of rudimentary 3D vision that you might see in like old video games, for example. And what that that process does and editing together that previs or that stunt choreography does is it gives us a pretty good reassurance that this is what we want to shoot. And so all that stuff, so in some ways, a lot of the movie is pre-shot before they even shoot with the actors. The other thing that needs to happen is, especially when you're interacting with props like that, like sliding around poles and stuff like that, that the stunt people need to make sure that those things are safe and the rigging is safe and things like that for the actors. And so there's a lot of planning that has to go in. Another scene that people love is the scaffolding scene. And a lot of the rigging that needed to happen and the camera moves that needed to happen needed to be pre-tested with all the stunt performers before Simu sort of was jumping around in that scaffolding, for example. A lot of this stuff is shot against green screen. So one of the things that this bus is in San Francisco, but you can't sort of run a bus up and down the hills of San Francisco multiple times. And so obviously you have to shoot in green screen. You have people running gimbals for the bus to make it shake in the right way. You've got sort of robotics to make the bus move in particular ways, et cetera. But all of it is against green screen. And then the other, what the VFX team does is, like, you know, those Google Photos cars, they have these like 360 cameras that run down Geary, for example, or run down Bush Street and capture this, like all the backgrounds that you're ultimately going to need to comp in. There's visual effects stuff like that need to happen. So even a shot as simple as when he like leans back and that pendant flies into the air, that pendant flies beautifully because it's CG. It's not, you know, obviously not like a real pendant that has to be there. And so we have to sort of like get the visual effects teams in early on to plan all of those shots too. And then once that all the cutting is done, the rhythm and the music really play a huge part in these scenes. This scene, this one in particular, because unlike traditional score, we used Run It, which was a needle drop or a song, right? And so you have to cut the song and the rhythms of the song and the elements of the song so that they drop out or become simplified or et cetera. And then you, so it takes us along with an army of like music editors to sort of put all of that together. And there was really close cooperation between 88 Rising, who provided most of our music, and us in the editorial team to choose the songs to for them to get us. Sometimes we said like, can we get a different drum track? Because we need something that's more bass heavy for this moment. And they were willing to change the song often so to shape it more to the scene. And so, I mean, I'm only getting at like 10% of like the kind of work that needs to go into a scene like this. But for us, like we just love those details. And one of the things that reasons I love editing so much is that we get to be the first audience for these things. And we get to see it take shape. We get to see it become snappier or more rhythmic and more fun and things like that. So we, all editors I know, really love movies because, you know, one of the things that makes all of those long hours and all of that hard work worth it is that we get to be the ones, you know, seeing things for the first time and seeing them, you know, layer by layer become the scenes that you get to love.
It's incredible how much preparation goes into shooting these scenes. So were any of these scenes shot on location? And like, was everything on a green screen, all the fight scenes? And did you get to go on set for anything?
I didn't get to go on set because I wasn't in Australia shooting with them, but it's very rare that they ask an editor to go on set unless there are things that need to happen in real time. So for example, on King Richard, the other movie that's coming out, the reason that I was on set was they wanted to make sure that the tennis looked good. And so they had pros playing tennis and then they had the actors coming in, but the actors couldn't do, obviously hit the way that the pros did. So they wanted to pre-cut some of the points in the matches to make sure that the actors were matching into it. So if there's real-time feedback that affects performance, then an editor usually needs to be on set. Another interesting example is on Euphoria. There's an episode that I cut where Rue, the main character, is stuck in bed almost through the entire episode because she's depressed. There's only so many ways that you can shoot somebody in a bed before it gets like repetitive and boring. And so Sam Levinson, who's, you know, such a visual innovator, wanted to be sure that we weren't repeating camera angles or moves, you know, from beat to beat. And so he wanted us to pre-cut that stuff while they were shooting to make sure, like, okay, there's visual interest is going on through the whole episode, and that we're shooting Rue from different angles so that when we keep finding her in bed, it's not the same shot over and over again. So those are pretty rare, though. For the most part, editors don't like to be on set, and here's why. A, we're lazy. But it's because we want the kind of objectivity that the audience has. The audience doesn't know that an actor is cranky that day. The audience doesn't know that it rained all day before you could get the shot and everybody was tired and miserable before this crane move. You know, because the audience doesn't know it, we need to advocate for the audience, and our subjective experience of what happens on set cannot influence the things that we choose. There's so many times where a director has come on board and said, like, oh my God, I hate this actor so much, you know, or I hate this like extra so much. And we're like, they're totally fine. You know, they're totally working. We need to use them. We need to be able to provide that objective feedback to say, they may have been terrible to you because they wouldn't come out of the trailer or whatever, you know, abuse you received, but the audience is going to love them because they have that special something, or this is working. And so we need that kind of objectivity. Often it makes us a little sad because we have this weird kind of stalkerish thing that we have to do where we're so tuned into an actor's performance. We feel like we know them intimately. And then when we meet them at the premiere, like, we're just like kind of staring at them like as if we had like a junior high school crush on them, you know, but like for them, like, this is the first time they're seeing us. So it's kind of, it gets to be this kind of like cognitive dissonance that happens where you know who they are in their most intimate moments and they have no idea who you are. But in general, we want to protect ourselves from that kind of thing.
Ah, this is incredible. So last time when you spoke, when we talked about Minari, you mentioned how you and Lee Isaac Chung had a very close relationship, and that you know, Lee was very responsive to suggestions and really valued your input in the film. And you also earlier talked about how much collaboration there is going on between all of the post-production team. So I was wondering, you know, what your relationship was like with Destin Daniel Cretton, and do you feel like, and he probably wouldn't be happy hearing me say this, but do you feel like the importance of an editor on a film like Shang-Chi, a Marvel film, almost surpasses that of a director in some ways, because of how, you know, post-production is so important, and I feel like it shapes so much of what the film turns out to be.
I think there's more for us to do, but I don't think that makes us more important. I think ultimately, ideally, especially on a feature film, your true north is the vision of the director, is the life experience or the way someone wants to tell a story. And I think the best editors are ones that don't ever try to supersede that, but to make that vision as clear and as delightful, as engaging, as, you know, any number of those adjectives as possible. And I think what you want is, I think as an editor, I think you want to be invested in the flourishing of the people that you work with. You know, you can't just be focused on, you know, is this the best thing for the cut, or is this the best thing for the movie? Ultimately, it's what we're all, that is, you know, that is the primary goal. But the other goal, I think, has to be, how do I create an environment in which this person who is an artist can do their best work, whether it's their first film or their 20th film? And so much of what you do as an editor is to create an environment in which they can be vulnerable, they can make mistakes, they can suggest stupid things, they can suggest the wrong things, even though you know it's wrong and probably not right for the cut, you'll explore it with them. And I think if you're not invested in that as a process, if you're not relational in that way, I think it's really hard to be a good editor. And that's one of the things that I've come to really love about this process. And you know, when I was making the decision to enter editing versus writing and directing, when I made the career change, when I was around 30 years old, you know, it was a conversation with a therapist in San Francisco that I had where I was like talking about the kind of creativity that I enjoyed, which was not like, oh, writing my own things and shooting my own things, but helping people make their stories and their films better. I found that that came so naturally to me. And she said that, you know, there are all these societies where that kind of collaborative creativity, that kind of nurturing creativity is the mode of creativity that people value most. And, you know, that may not necessarily be the primary mode and, you know, where we're, you know, where we're, what we grow up with. But, you know, it could be useful for you to embrace that as a different mode. And I think that, you know, I think not to be too cheesy about this, but I think having a more open perspective as I gained at Williams, you know, of constantly questioning my assumptions and sort of deconstructing sort of like my presumptions about the way certain things should be done really helped me to embrace that and to say like, okay, no, this is something that I can pursue and be proud of. I still get a lot of questions, but even from my parents after all this time, they'd be like, okay, this is great. You're really successful as an editor, but when are you going to direct, you know? But like, you know, and it's natural to say that. And I feel like I could be a great director because of all this experience, but I really enjoy that. I mean, I really enjoy that aspect of what I do. And, you know, just circling back to your question about Destin, he's somebody that is as relational, is as, I think, gives dignity to everybody that he works with. And that's just part of who he is. Maybe it's because he grew up in Hawaii. Maybe it's because he's Hapa. And so, you know, he knows what it comes, what it feels like to not be of one world or another. You know, it's just his nature. And I think that's one of the things I really, really respected was that he created that kind of family environment in which everybody was accepted and given the opportunity to do their best work. And so it was wonderful to be a part of that.
That is really wonderful. And so speaking of your family, you know, last time you mentioned how you like screened Minari for your family together and how meaningful that was. So how were their reactions to Shang-Chi this time? Especially given that it's such a different film from everything that you've
seen
before. And I don't know, they're probably very familiar with Tony Leung and Michelle Yeoh and probably grew up watching a lot of their films.
Well, I think they kind of knew Tony Leung, but like they didn't watch a lot of Hong Kong films, you know, because they're Korean. So it's stuff that we all grew up watching and really loved. But I do have a photo I want to share of, let me see. So here's a photo. Can everybody see this? This is a photo of, I think a month ago, I rented a theater in Emeryville for my parents and some of their church friends to be able to watch Shang-Chi safely. And this is kind of what I dreamed of doing for Minari, but unfortunately, when Minari came out, like vaccines and things like that weren't as readily available, and you know, and it wasn't as safe. But it was so wonderful to kind of realize this dream of like wanting to share an Asian American story with my parents and you know, people of their generation, you know, with this movie. I think they really enjoyed it. I think they really enjoyed the action of it. I suspect that they probably identified a little bit more with Minari as a story and in terms of life experience. But yeah, they really had a good time. I think they enjoyed as much the free popcorn that we bought for them as the movie itself, but I think they had a good time. While I'm here, I'll just show you a couple of other pictures. So here's a photo of my cutting room. I blurred out some stuff just because, you know, I don't want Marvel to hunt me down. But the couple of details in the cutting room that you can see is that's my desk. There's a lot of screens. There's always a lot of screens on an editor's desk. In the far background, you see lots of little photos and they're divided by reels. One of the ways that we make movies, feature films, more manageable is that we divide them into chunks, usually anywhere from 10 to 20 minutes long, that we call reels. And that's how we kind of pass the project back and forth to each other. For example, this movie was divided up into 10 reels. I was in charge of reels 6 through 10, and Nat Sanders, who was the editor, was involved in charge of reels 1 through 5. And we would pass reels back and forth with the various teams that we were working with, visual effects editors, et cetera. The scene cards that you see back there as well also help when we're talking about, if we remove this scene or if we move this scene to another place, what's around it? How is it gonna reverberate through the rest of the film? So it's a snapshot of the film as we do things like restructure. What's happening in this moment? Another thing to point out is on the left, in the big screen, you see what looks like a really kind of complex timeline there. That's a snapshot of the Avid. The sort of green and yellow tracks and the blue tracks that you see are picture tracks. The purple, orange, and blue tracks that you see below are audio tracks. We're often dealing with anywhere from, 5 to 12 picture tracks, depending upon how many visual effects are involved. We're dealing with about 24 audio tracks, depending upon how complex the mix is. And so that timeline represents the movie as we're editing it and shaping it, et cetera. What's happening in this moment is that on my laptop screen that I've blurred out is Michelle Yeoh, and she's being shot against a green screen in London, while as you can see in my iPad screen, that's a Zoom link of our director, visual effects people, talking with the DP and the director of photography that happens to be in London and coordinating that shoot. What you're seeing in the other screens is a previs sample of that's where the 3D characters, as I mentioned earlier, of the scene where Michelle Yeoh is walking with our heroes and explaining the legend of Talo against the wooden mural. So we planned all of that out in previs, and what we're doing is we're shooting the Michelle Yeoh plate for the ultimate shot here. And we had to shoot Michelle separate from the other actors because she was in London and our other actors were in Los Angeles. And so it just tells you the kind of logistical complication that it takes to do this kind of film. So, and the complexity of like a lot of the technology that we had to deal with. And as you can also see, center screen is Purell hand sanitizer, which, is a little artifact of COVID, hopefully an artifact that we will be less familiar with as the months come by. These are the other two editors on the red carpet, Nat Sanders and Elizabeth Ronald's daughter. This is a shot of our mix stage. As I mentioned, this is us in Los Angeles. Destin is the one that's giving the shaka in the mid-ground there, other editors, producers, music editors, composers, etc. in the background. And if you can see the TV screen in the far background, those are our mixers in Skywalker in Marin that we're remoting in with. And this is a shot of the entire crew. One of the things that we used to do on Fridays is we would all wear Hawaiian shirts because Destin's from Hawaii and he wanted us to sort of chill out on Fridays and to remember to chill out a little bit. So a lot of us wore Hawaiian shirts for this final crew picture. Next to Destin in is our producer, Jonathan Schwartz in the center, and Kevin Feige in the black shirt. He's sort of one of the executive producers that's been involved with Marvel since Iron Man. And just wanted to share a little slideshow of a taste of what Shang-Chi posts look like.
Thank you for sharing all these photos. It's so fun, and I think the audience really enjoyed seeing them. So I'm nearing the end of my questions, but I just have one last question. I was curious what you're thinking about for your next project, if anything, and are you more excited now to work on more action-driven films like Shang-Chi and Marvel, or do you still enjoy editing the whole range of different types of films?
Yeah, I think I focused a little less on genre and more on people. I think I was as excited to work with Destin as I was to work on a Marvel film. And so I really sort of evaluate my projects, and thankfully I'm so blessed these days to have a choice of projects, but so much of it is geared towards what filmmakers am I excited to work with? What stories am I excited to tell? So the boxing movie that got shut down during COVID, thank God, has had a chance to have a second life. The director of the movie is Rachel Morrison, who was the DP of Black Panther and Mudbound, Fruitvale Station. I mean, she's an incredible DP. And this will be her feature directorial debut. And so I'm super excited to work with Rachel. And it's a wonderful story called Flint Strong. And so that's going to shoot sometime in spring of next year. And before that, I'm due to cut a pilot starring Steven Yeun and Ali Wong. It's a Netflix project called Beef. And it's going to be a dark comedy that stars the two of them. It's a really, really fun script. The showrunner is a Korean-American showrunner named Sunny Lee, who's brilliant and who I'm so excited to work with. So I feel very, very blessed that I have two projects kind of lined up that I'm really, really excited about, both for their content and for the makers that are focusing on them.
That is wonderful. I'm so excited to see both of them. I saw announcements about the Steven Yeun and Ali Wong show going around, and it's so exciting to hear that you're actually editing it. So thank you, Harry. And I'm going to pass it back to Lindsay, who will moderate our Q&A. So the audience, you guys should feel free to ask any questions in the chat, and Lindsay will ask what we can, given the time we have.
Thank you, Angela.
So if anyone has any questions, feel free to, I guess we have one right now. Was there from Peter, sorry if I butcher your last name, Tosurisa, was there a particularly difficult scene that you thought really wasn't working, and what changes did you make to resolve this to get it to screen ready?
I think it was, for Nat, it was definitely the dinner scene, because dinner scenes are often so much about exposition, and what's interesting about exposition in a Marvel film is that you're not only doing exposition that's critical to the building of character, but also the building of world. So like if you're doing a traditional drama, you don't have to explain to the audience how gravity works, you know? Whereas in a Marvel film, you have to explain the origin of powers, you know, the origin of worlds and things like that. So it becomes particularly challenging. So he went a number of different rounds on that dinner scene. For me, because everything in the flashback affected your experience of the finale of Shang-Chi sort of becoming the hero that he's supposed to be, for me, it was really sort of that last final battle. That battle was much longer than what you see now, and really the kind of emotional story of his journey kind of ends when Wu passes away and gives the rings, gives the rings to Shang-Chi as a character. And so once that emotional story is done, there is a kind of, you know, finishing of the third act that needs to happen that kind of solidifies his stature as a hero. But, you know, as with so many things editorially, you want just enough and no more. You want to sort of leave the audience wanting more. And there was so much there in terms of resolution that they had originally scripted and shot, and there were all these visual effects in the works. And I needed to be the jerk who said, like, okay, let's stop all of that. I wonder if it would be better if we took this out, et cetera. And then as a result of taking a lot of those things out, we needed to restructure the middle of the movie to make sure that the trajectory of certain characters weren't heading toward a finale that wasn't there. I'm being vague on purpose because I can't tell you a lot of that stuff because, you know, again, Marvel would hunt me down, but that was the most challenging aspect of it. And even as short as it is, I think we've gotten comments that it still feels too long, but I think that means that emotionally the movie's working the way that it's supposed to be, which is, you know, that Shang-Chi's journey, particularly in relationship with Tony Leung as a father, is, you know, is one of the most sort of emotionally satisfying parts of the movie. So, yeah.
And then a question from LS Kim. What difference does it make for you to work with Asian American directors and performers?
Yeah, I have to say, like, I think one of the things that was a priority for Destin was to make sure that in terms of like the Chinese, that the Chinese was right. In terms of the Asian American cultural moments, that that was right. And it was so wonderful to work with somebody for whom that was a priority, because it's not always the case. And so I think, sorry, my screen just turned blue. Get rid of the blue screen here. So I think every director, every showrunner's priorities are different. And sometimes, you know, they don't always lead towards cultural authenticity. And I think it makes a huge difference for, you know, somebody who's trying to do a cultural milestone film like this, to be invested that things feel accurate, things feel true. And, you know, you also find a lot of common ground. You know, Destin and I had a lot of conversations about what it was like to grow up with an Asian dad, you know, and that really informed. And I know that he had similar conversations with Dave, who was our writer, you know. And so those things, those little details, those nuances really inform what feels like true north for the people that are making the film. And the other thing for Isaac and I mean, it was just, you know, I knew from the first interview that I'd found sort of a brother from another mother, and that kind of affinity and that kind of like common ground just makes the process of spending hours and hours together working on something that much more enjoyable. So yeah, it makes a huge difference. And I have to tell you guys, you know, one of the things that, you know, made me want to go into film in the first place was taking my first Asian American history and Asian American literature courses at Williams, and finding all of these undiscovered stories where I felt grounded in an American experience. And that was such an emotional thing for me, that it was always my dream working in film to work on shows that would do the same thing for other people. And so, you know, years and years later, it feels like that dream has come true in films like Minari and Shang-Chi. And it's been such a blessing to see that kind of Asian American content not only sort of be available, but to reach a much broader stage and to be commercially viable as well. Because I think there's real support among the Asian American community and beyond for this type of content. So I'm like living the dream right now. It's incredible how many projects that have Asian American leads that that I get a chance to take a look at and hopefully be a part of.
That sounds so cool. And expanding beyond that, even, like, is there like a director from Hao Tianxu? Mm-hmm. Is there a director, a producer, an actor, anybody that you would love to work with, given the chance to live the dream more?
I really respected the work that Justin Chan's been doing recently. I feel like his trio of films on marginal Korean American stories have really kind of blown me away. I mean, they're not necessarily technically the most perfect films, but I really love the heart that's in them. And so I just really respect him as an artist. I mean, I would kill to be a second editor on any of Denis Villeneuve's films. I know his primary editor, Joe Walker, and he's incredible. But yeah, if they ever need help on anything, I would love to do that. I saw a preview screening of Dune and it just blew me away. It's just like, it's pure cinema. It's absolutely gorgeous. I love the scale of both large and small that Denis is able to tell. I also had the privilege of, you know, being an additional editor on Damien Chazelle's First Man, and would love to work with him and Tom Cross again on something else that they work with. There's just such a facility that Damien has with editing, with storytelling through the cinematic art form, that I just feel like I learn from working with people like that, that just breathe cinema. So that's just off the top of my head, but there's There's so many. And I'm super excited to work with Rachel Morrison on Flint Strong. She's somebody that, you know, has such a unique vision because she was such an accomplished DP before becoming an editor, before becoming a director. And so I'm really, really excited to learn from her and to collaborate with her, so.
Also speaking about working with people, Brendan Stennard mm-hmm. Asked how it was like working with Sam Levinson.
Oh my gosh, Sam is so incredible. I mean, he's so incredible. When you're reading the scripts, when we were reading for the scripts for Euphoria, he had these prompts to play songs as we were reading so that we could experience that sort of beautiful melding of music and image that he's so good at. And what's incredible about Sam is that he's not just so practiced in sort of newer kinetic dynamic things that you can do with the camera that's in present day, but he's also, because he grew up sitting on the couch watching Turner Classic Movies with his father Barry Levinson, who's like a legendary director in his own right, and so he knows the history of cinema in a way, and so you get both of those things working with such energy and with such, I mean, the fact that he writes every episode of Euphoria is mind-blowing, and that he's so prolific in his writing that I remember once there was an episode with an entirely different plot line that he just threw out and then rewrote that entire episode in the course of like a couple of weeks. It's just mind-blowing to see somebody who's that prolific, but also the quality of the stuff that he does is incredible. And so yeah, I mean, every so often you meet somebody like that and you just want to, you just want to quit, because they're so amazing, So no, I mean, it just really inspires you. And Sam Levinson, he's the real deal. He's amazing. Hi, Meg. I said hello.
Well, lots of connections here. And then someone asked, Andrew O asked, he said that he is also a filmmaker and an editor, and he was wondering what kind of first steps that you took coming out of college, especially considering that Williams isn't like a specialized film school.
Yeah, I think Williams is amazing preparation for being a filmmaker. I think to be a great editor, you have to also be a filmmaker. You have to be as invested in shot design, in mise-en-scène, in production design, performance, all of those things, because you have to be in dialogue with the director or the showrunner through the post-production process. And it can't just be about good cuts. It has to be about like an understanding of story and where it's headed, an understanding of performance and what feels over the top or what feels nuanced and specific, I think. And in order to be a good filmmaker, I think it takes digesting a wide variety of films, particularly films in sort of the canon of great films that have been around for over 100 years. And so I think it's really important to sort of watch a lot. And thankfully, there was a lot of even though we didn't have a film program, there were professors like Sean Rosenheim and that really provided classes where we could watch a variety of films, analyze them, talk about them with the other really brilliant students that we were going to school with, and to start to digest an understanding of what is specific in terms of this kind of storytelling that you can do in the cinematic medium, not just in terms of picture, but in terms of sound, in terms of music, in a holistic way. And so I think having a curious mind and being interested in a lot of different things, not just in film, but through your liberal arts background, is going to really help you, because we become experts in whatever story that we happen to be telling. So because I'm going to be working on a boxing movie, I'm going to watch not only boxing films, but also boxing matches. I'm going to want to sort of understand what are the mechanics of boxing that we should be displaying, how do we create a subjective reality of a boxer, and know what True North is without doing some sort of study, you know, in that. And not just as a boxer, but what is it like to grow up in Flint, Michigan and during this time? Like, what is it like to be a woman boxer? You know, what is it like to be in the Olympics? Like, we become studies of the films that we become involved in, and we become immersed in those worlds. And having the facility to kind of dive in, ask critical questions, and start digesting that and making that a part of your storytelling DNA is a kind of skill set that I think you gain from, you know, your experience at Williams. And so I felt like it was wonderful preparation for being a more versatile storyteller.
And speaking about watching many, many films, Sarah Megan Thomas asks, what is your favorite film, particularly from an editing standpoint?
Oh, wow. I was going to say what, so from an editing standpoint, I think one of my favorite films is a film called Traffic that balances multiple storylines, jumping back and forth between timelines, and, you know, maintains a wonderful tension throughout. I also really love Arrival, which is a more recent film, science fiction film starring that directed by Denis Villeneuve. And I love how, you know, it's such a complex story, but it's so beautifully told. And, you know, throughout, there is a kind of emotional through line that they're able to do, even though there's so much complexity in the story and in the world that they're creating. And that film kind of resonates with me today. My favorite film in general, though, is a Kurosawa film called Ikiru, which is it's a simple story, it's a long story of a petty bureaucrat in Tokyo that learns that he has cancer. And through the course of the film, he tries to, in various ways, figure out what the meaning of his life is about. So is it about family? Is it about, you know, ephemeral pleasure? Is it about, you know, a sense of meaning in his job, etc.? And, you know, what I love about the film is that it's both kind of like very humanistic at its core. It tells an uplifting story, but it grounds it in kind of the reality, the cynical reality of the world that we live in. And the kinds of cinematic storytelling that Kurosawa is able to do in each sequence really opened my eyes to what was possible in film versus, and how it was different from stage plays and novels, paintings, you know, all these other art forms that we're exposed to. This was specific to cinema, and it was one of the first times that I really felt it.
And then Maddie Donahue asked, you briefly talked about trying to remain unbiased while editing. Are there any, or were there any extreme methods you took to remain as pure as the audience?
I mean, it's hard. I think the best way to do it is to be in the room with somebody who's a new audience. That's why we love feedback screenings. We couldn't do the first ones in person because they were all in Florida. And so it felt like kind of like there was a detachment there because we couldn't feel the electricity in the room. And it's so important to trigger your ability to take off your creator hat and to put on your audience hat at every stage of the process. So, you know, one of the things that I do at every stage, like when I cut a scene for the first time, I watch it myself and I feel like, oh, it's perfect. And then I always invite somebody into the room, like my assistant or, you know, the PA or somebody to watch it with me. Because as soon as you have somebody else in the room, you're like, oh, wait, that shot's way too long. Or, oh my gosh, this cut is really not working because it's confusing. Even before they say a thing. You just have to sort of like trigger that audience perspective, taking off your sort of creator and problem solver hat and putting yourself into a different mode. And the most effective way that I can do that is by literally sitting with somebody at the same time, whether it's one person or it's 300 people like we do in a recruited audience. That's what the other thing that I'd say of anybody who's interested in editing is you have to be fearless and you can't be precious about your work. I don't care if it took you all day of, you know, sweat and energy to put a cut together. If it's not effective for an audience, you have to take it apart. And it's not real until you put it in front of somebody and you get a sense of whether it's working or not. And so I think having that kind of egolessness and that trust in the reworking and the re-editing as part of your process is a really critical muscle to develop. So if you're an editor and you're not showing things, if you're too precious about, and if you're a filmmaker and you're not showing things, then it really kind of stunts your growth. It stunts your ability to do the re-editing, which I think is so critical to anybody's growth and refinement of their skill set.
Having spent so much time like editing, you know, so much of the film, Daniel E. Silva asks,
Hi, Daniel.
Given the collaborative, iterative nature of editing, at what point is, you know, the CGI worked into the storyline as the live action is being cut or after?
There are often placeholders. So it's all in parallel. Like I said, there's a lot of previs. So like we have a dragon in the third act. And so there's previs of how the dragon's going to interact with our actors. So we have a sense of, that's primarily for a sense of timing and blocking. So the timing of how long an action is going to take, but also sort of where our heroes in relation to the dragon. Are they 1,000 feet away? Or are they 100 feet away? Does it sweep by them? So, you know, those things have an impact on rhythm and shot length and things like that. So, but there's also sometimes proxies, like whether it's like a ball that the actors are looking at, things like that. And that gives you a sense of timing as well. So it's this constant iterative process. You do the best that you can to pick the plates that you can, the performances that you can, and the order in which you think it's going to work. And then you turn it over to visual effects, and then you get it back and you realize, okay, what I thought was necessary is not necessary, or what I thought was enough is not enough. And so you take things away, you add things, you change blocking, et cetera, and you're constantly iterating. And one of the skill sets you have to have, particularly on a visual effects heavy film, is how long do those iterations take? You know, how do I account for that baking time for visual effects to come back before we know we're finally done? For really complex renders, like that dragon, for example, like, and all the water that happens in the third act, at some point our visual effects supervisor was like, you know that Weta, who was doing a lot of those shots, is the highest power consumer in all of New Zealand now because of their render farms for our shots. And so like, so there's so much computing power going on to try to turn those things around. And sometimes those really complex shots sometimes took days, weeks in order to do a single iteration. So you have to take that into account and you have to budget that in terms of like how you measure out your creative decisions and your priorities.
But many of them did turn out like amazing. And in particular, so Peter Tesserisa, sorry about the last name again. He particularly asks like is there like a scene or a shot or a cut in Shang-Chi that you are personally the most proud of?
Gosh, that's a good question. I think it's like towards the end of the film, there's it's a really simple scene, but like the final scene in the restaurant, you know, that's at the end of the film. It was so much fun to kind of shape the comedy of that scene. And, you know, I haven't caught a lot of comedy, and to sort of like have fun with the actors and to have it interact with the visual effects and stuff like that. Because that kind of cutting is like, it's almost totally independent from, you know, a lot of the visual effects heavy stuff that we had to do. I just really, really enjoyed that scene. I don't know if it's the one that I'm most proud of, but I think it's really funny. And I think it's really, and I think it provides the tonally the kind of right ending for that movie before the tag scenes come in. So I really enjoyed cutting that.
And speaking about humor, Dante Hirata Epstein asked, who came up with the joke about Venmo at the end of Shang-Chi?
Oh, I think it was Dave Callahan, one of our writers. He also came up with the joke about Planet of the Apes. I don't know if you remember that scene. During one of our feedback screenings, one of our respondents said that Planet of the Apes joke is the funniest joke in the entire history of the MCU. And so we related that to Dave, which he was very proud of. So
Okay. Well, thank you so much. Unfortunately, we're running short on time, so we'll be cutting off the Q&A, but thank you everyone for sending questions, and I'm passing it back to Xiaowei.
Thank you guys for all your awesome questions. Hi, Catherine.
Wow. So that was incredible. Thank you so much, Harry. You've really given us a fascinating behind the scenes look at how an action blockbuster is made. We hope to have you again, back again soon. It was great to hear about the technical aspects of the film. It definitely gives us a new appreciation and makes me want to watch it again. And lastly, I have to say, I'm sure the admissions office would love to hear this recording, because I think you've been the perfect advertisement for a liberal arts education. You're talking about your breadth and variety of experiences and the challenging assumptions and all of that. So thank you so much for taking the time to speak to us, and hope to be in touch again soon. Thank you also to Angela and Lindsay for moderating, and Gisarelli for the logistical support. And to everyone else, please keep an eye out for future WAAAAN announcements, and have a great night, everyone.